So don't tell me you ain't got it or you can't do something. Yeah, everybody's spitting, but they ain't saying nothing. I'm just trying to make a difference, give you something to think about. I ain't worried about a status or some goddamn clout. If you see me in the streets, don't be afraid to shout them, but I'm out.
Yo. What's up? What's good with all my bull lifers out there? So it's super hard for me to crack a smile right now just because I just finished watching that abomination. There's no need to even make this a super long video, so let's hop straight into it, right? All right, we all expected the Bulls to lose this game. Obviously, we are short on bodies and we're playing the best team in the NBA right now in the Golden State Warriors, right? So no one really expected the Bulls to win this game, to say the least. But I did actually look for certain things tonight. And those certain things were effort, defensive schemes, shot selections, team offense, and individual play. First and foremost, defensive scheme and effort. Now, not too many teams can contain the Golden State Warriors, right? So, I mean, you got to give them the benefit of the doubt with that, right? But what I didn't like was there had seemed to be no defensive game plan for this team. I guess it's hard to even game plan against this team, but I could barely tell what the Bulls were running out there. I couldn't tell if they was doing a man-to-man, if they was playing a 3-2 zone, or what. I couldn't tell. They basically came out and did whatever they wanted to do. That three-point line was like, it was just open. It was like throwing a rock in the ocean. It was literally that wide. And the Bulls seemingly couldn't do anything to stop him. Klay Thompson was open at least like 60% of the time from three. Hell, probably more than that, man. And even the Bulls even let the kid off of the bench, McKinney, they even let him come in to get off. It was just open season. I didn't see any hard-nosed defense from anyone, really. Besides, you know, the kid who had got in later on, but I'll get into him later, talking about Shaq Harrison. And Wendell Carter Jr., you know, he's a front court player, so it was only so much that he could do. But I'm talking about in terms of perimeter defense, it was pretty much non-existent. I saw Zach LaVine, he got caught on a lot of switches. I saw him trying to go under a couple picks. Like, why would you try to do that versus the Warriors? I get it, he was trying to gamble, he was trying to trust his speed, but no, you just don't do that with certain teams, or at least this particular team. You just don't do that. If we're talking about defense, okay, I get that there wasn't much that you could do to contain the Warriors, but you don't let them set NBA records, individual records, franchise records, all three in the same freaking game. Klay Thompson legit set the three-point record for 14 three-pointers in the game. They let the Dubs score an NBA record for 17 threes in a half. And they also let them score a franchise record of 92 points and a half. Like, dude, defense is straight up effort, man. It's straight up effort and scheme. And I can't lie, I saw effort out of some of the players out there. I did. But at the same time, to me, I just chalk it up to boiling, man. Because there's no way. I get that the Warriors are a superior team. Clearly, who doesn't know that? But our defensive scheme is just non-existent. I don't know what we were running out there. It was just absolutely horrible to me. So next, I want to talk about shot selections. Early on, I felt like the Bulls were in their element. They, like, early on in the first quarter, they had pretty decent shot selections. They weren't trying to, like, you know, do too much until the Warriors began to pull away. Once the Warriors began to pull away, players like Justin Holiday come down, jack up a three. You know, Jabari Parker doing his usual, coming down, jack up a three. But the difference was they tried to keep up with the Warriors' pace of shots. They started jacking up a bunch of threes, and not even just threes, but just trying to take super quick shots before they could even run a play. And that's the spell that the Warriors puts on most teams that they play against, right? They get teams to play out of their element and have teams try to play their game, which there aren't many teams in the NBA that can play the Warriors style of basketball. So when the Bulls began to do that, it was just downhill from there. It was just over. Like, what I think that the Bulls have to do against a team like the Warriors is they have to stay within their offense, which they need a good offense to run first and foremost, but they have to play their own game. But the biggest thing against the Warriors has to be effort, which is getting up in their jerseys, like legit, like on every player out there, rebounding, hustling for loose balls. Like, the Warriors are just everywhere. They're everywhere. They're all over the floor, and all of them play hard-nosed defense, hustle, and rebound. You're not going to be able to match them offensively, but if you do all of the other intangible things, then I think that you have at least a shot against this Warriors team. The Rockets proved that last season because they matched pretty much everything that the Warriors was doing in terms of, like, all of the intangibles, except they just had the offensive prowess to go along with it last season. I don't know, man. As far as team offense, the team, they early on, they were running the ball through Zach LaVine like they should have. Zach LaVine is our star player out there, especially on the offensive end. And I really felt like they tried to get Zach LaVine going a little bit early on. And Zach LaVine, he did what he does. You know, he was out there scoring the basketball effectively, pretty efficiently as well. So I wasn't necessarily mad at the team offense necessarily. But, I mean, once Zach LaVine went off of the floor, our bench would come in. I actually liked what I saw out of Jabari Parker, you know, running the offense, being a distributor out there. I really like him in that second unit as well. Like, our team offense, it wasn't horrible. It's just it cannot match the Warriors. Period, point blank. It can't match the Warriors. And also, the Warriors are a really good defensive team as well. The Bulls were trying to hit the open man. I did see some ball movement out there, but we just don't have good enough offensive players who can consistently knock down those open shots. As simple as that. And when I talk about individual play, I'll start off with Zach LaVine. He had 21.6 rebounds, 2 steals, and 3 turnovers. Like I said, Zach LaVine, he looked really good out there. He is continuing to do his thing on the offensive end. I really liked his shot selections. Like, he wasn't taking shots that were out of his element. Zach LaVine is looking like a really good three-point shooter. He was taking really hard drives to the basket. He was getting to the free throw line like he should have. I thought that Zach LaVine had a really nice offensive game. Defensively, I mean, pretty much no one's defense was anything to speak of. Like I said, Zach LaVine was getting caught on switches. He was getting caught trying to gamble, and he had to pay for it. So not a good defensive night from Zach LaVine individually. Next, I want to talk about Jabari Parker. He had 15 points, 9 rebounds, 6 assists, and he shot 7 for 15 from the field goal. Jabari Parker, he looks perfect coming off of the bench, man. Which I think that Fred Hoiberg wants him to continue to come off the bench. I really want to see what they're going to do with him once Lloyd Marketing gets back. I wonder if they're going to try to insert him into the lineup as the 3. I don't necessarily know if I agree with that move, just because I definitely think that we will need his help off of the bench. And once Lloyd Marketing gets back, Chris Dunn, Wendell Carter Jr. is looking like a nice defensive player in the starting lineup. And, of course, Zach LaVine, I don't necessarily know if we need Jabari Parker in the starting lineup. And he and Zach LaVine don't seem to gel too well on the floor together. I don't have their stats right here in front of me, but just sometimes when I see them out there, they have bright spots. But I don't know, I feel like they overlap each other a little bit. I don't know. I'm going to have to see them play together a little bit more to see how it unfolds, you know, during at least half of the season. But like I said, I like Jabari Parker coming off of the bench. He's the leader out there on the floor. as far as the bench, and no need to talk about his defense. Wendell Carter Jr., he had 18 points, 7 rebounds, 4 assists. He shot 7 for 13 from the field goal. I really liked what I saw out of Wendell Carter Jr. out there. I really thought that he was out there hustling. He was grabbing boards. He was banging bodies with the Warriors bigs. He actually was taking shots within the offense. I saw him get a lot of open jumpers at the free throw line. He actually got a lot of cut baskets as well off of pick and roll. So Wendell Carter Jr., he had himself a pretty nice game. I really liked what I saw him doing out there on the defensive end as well. The Warriors really just killed us from the three-point line. That's pretty much what it was like. But Wendell Carter Jr., he was out there battling, so there's not much that I can knock about Wendell Carter Jr. I actually saw him get a really nice highlight dunk on Jordan Bell, where he dunked on him for an and-one. Like, I loved that play when I saw that one. Like, I got up out my seat for that one. That was pretty much the only time of the night that I did, but that one made me happy. I'll chip in campaign. He chipped in 15 points. He looked pretty nice out there in the starting lineup as well. I thought he was out there battling too. He hit a couple three-pointers, and he actually got to the basket for a few nice contested lay-ins on Steph Curry. So I liked what I saw out of campaign out there. He was out there. He was hustling. He was battling hard on the offensive end, but we took an L, so it really doesn't matter. But who really, really stood out to me was Shaq, man. Shaq Harrison. That dude, man, all right, to read off his stats, he had 13 points, 4 rebounds, 3 assists, 2 steals, and he shot 5 for 8. Now, don't get me wrong, it was in garbage time. His minutes really came in garbage time. But just looking at him out there, this dude goes after it, and I love players who go after it. Like, I really loved what I saw out of him, just in terms of heart, just in terms of hustle, just in terms of grit. He was out there diving for loose balls. He was all up in players' jerseys. Like, he was being a distributor out there. He was playing very unselfishly, you know, out there, you know, jumping for rebounds. Like, he looks like a very, very nice grab for us. Like, he is a much more of an energy player than Chandler Hutchinson out there, if you ask me. And it might have a little bit to do with athleticism. No, it's not. It's effort. Like, this dude, he just has effort. Like, he goes hard out there. Like, he looks like Chris Dunn out there, as a matter of fact. He looks like he wants to be out there. He's hungry. He's hungry, and I love that about him. So, definitely big ups to that kid. He definitely needs to be getting more playing time. So, that's pretty much it. This video actually went on a little bit longer than I expected to, but this is a game that the Bulls definitely are gonna want to forget. It's one that I'm definitely gonna forget. Anyway, man, I hope y'all enjoyed the video just as much as I enjoyed bringing it to you. It's your man, Wise Black. You guys connect with me on social media at @radical_creator. That's Twitter and Instagram, and I'll see you in the next video. Peace.